Hello, welcome to the Checkpoint this week with me, Vivian Kamsimi. Now, recently, President Yoweri Kaguta Museveni assented to the Market Act of 2023 after review by Parliament of clauses relating to market executive committees. I speak to Honorable Dr. Biaka Tonda, who is a Member of Parliament, a Workers MP there, and Mr. Hassan Kiria, coming from Uganda Markets and Employees Act. You're welcome, gentlemen.
Thank you.
We would like to understand if this Market Act of 2023 is going to be ending the unending conflicts that have been going on in markets between the vendors and these executive markets and the leaderships of local governments there. And I would like to start with you, Mr. Hassan. Mm-hmm. Do you think that this law is actually going to stop these conflicts that have been happening between the vendors, the market executive committees, between the local authorities like KCCA that actually get to administrate over these markets? Do you think all this is going to end with this new law?
Thank you.
I would like to, first of all, send my greetings to all vendors in the country. Who I represent in Uganda Markets and Allied Employees Union. I would also want to send my greetings to the Executive Committee of Uganda Markets and Allied Employees Union. First of all, I don't believe that we had those disturbances that you're talking about in the markets. And for a long time, those committees have been in those markets for all these years. Over 8 years, since 1942 when they were actually...
You're talking about the market executive committees.
I'm talking about the market executive committees. And, but then all of a sudden, and maybe from Kampala, you get these disturbances of recent. Because for all those years, I don't think we have had those problems. There are markets like now, for example, in Akawa Market. That market is being managed actually by KCCA. Now you're talking about the confusion, the extortion, you're talking about some of these other problems. Now who is causing the problems in those public markets which are managed by KCCA? How can you say that the coming out of this law is going to solve anything? Solve what?
Let me just read for you what it is going to solve, because I have excerpts of some speech from the one who actually introduced these amendments, and that is Workers MP Margaret Rashija, who said that there has been need to bring this bill because there have been several wrangles among the managers and vendors since there was no law in place. Now she says that if implemented, these acts will minimize conflict and fights between vendors and landlords, and also realign governance and ownership challenges within the markets. And again, just to answer what you're saying, she continues to say that the Markets Act of 1942 did not provide for management of vendors, including the involvement of vendors in the affairs of the markets, and vendors' registration. In addition, the law did not make provisions for determination of market fees, revenue collection. These are the issues that she is saying this new law is going to be rectifying. Also, she says the absence of regularized modalities on management of vendors, revenue determination and collection has resulted in unending conflict between market operators and vendors, and I'm quoting her verbatim. Okay. So these are the issues that we are talking about, and we have seen openly even in the media there have been fights between market vendors and authorities.
Now, because I just want to be talking about the period before and after, because now this amendment was initiated by us. I just want you to get me on record. Was initiated by us vendors. Because first of all, we wanted to have a say in how markets are established and managed. Okay?
Mm.
But even previously, there was nothing like that, because the committees that were in the markets were actually managed by the local authorities. So where was the confusion coming from? The confusion is only coming from one thing. There are people who are bent on grabbing land in Kampala, in KCCA. Because elsewhere, I don't think there is this kind of confusion that you are talking about. But it's only St. Balikudembe, Nakasero Market, Lufula, and maybe Kiseka Market. That's where the confusion is coming from. But in the event, they also confuse it with other markets that are peaceful. For example, me, I come from Chirekameni Market. We don't have any confusion there. We are working with the local authorities properly. Even in the other markets, I have been to Elegu Market, I went to Chitugu Market, I was in Guru Market, all these areas, Lira Market, all these markets are peaceful.
Really?
Yes.
Let me just bring in Honorable here, Honorable Abdul Biakatonda. Do you think, from what you're hearing him saying, were the consultations that you made to have this law, have it passed, were the consultations enough that now you think that the vendors are actually going to be able to overcome the conflicts that they have had in the markets?
Thank you, Vivian. I want to thank you for hosting us tonight. I think I was on Urban TV about a year ago when we were having an impasse between science teachers and art teachers. That's when I came around. I want to first of all congratulate Ugandans for having this bill enacted into law. I think the law had basically become so obsolete, because this was a law which was enacted in 1948, I think about 82 years ago.
Mm.
And I want to thank the private member who brought the bill and subsequently the interface with government in allowing it move up this stage when His Excellency has sent it to it. I think what I want to say is that, one, we need really to have a legal infrastructure that can guide the processes. For example, in the UK, by 1970, I think that's when they started streamlining their markets. And I would like to mention that even the European Union, I think, systems have come. You know, when we are having a bill, for example, the private members bill, there was some clearances here and there. For example, the certificate of financial implication. So I think that's when it is allowed, then it means government has actually okayed it. Then an interface between the government and the private member, then the entire house. Of course, under Article 91, there is normally there are a lot of engagements that are done. It is done, consulted, then up to the level when they send the president. So I must say I was privy to this bill, and I know that stakeholders were consulted.
Vendors.
Mr. Kiria here will correct whether they were some of the people were consulted.
Mm.
And then, of course, up the level when the bill reached the debate and then forwarded to the president for assent.
Mm.
So, but suffice to mention is that, one, there are a number of unique things that exist in this bill. For example, in terms of regulation, we see that it is having the minister for Kampala Capital City Authority, where KCCA markets are concerned, and then it's having the Minister for Local Government, where markets and the local authorities are concerned. So these are the two. So this now means that actually these two must harmonize and ensure that maybe by coming up with the regulations. Because when a bill is assented to and it's now an act, there should be regulations by the minister. We should come and ensure that they fill in these gaps and then operationalization of the act. So these are very key things. But I want to say that, one, the mechanisms. But what I want to mention is that, one, we are looking at how we can operationalize this act. Of course, there are a number of issues. For example, when you read under section 21, subsection 11, where they're talking of if you're a public servant in any local authority, you're not supposed to have any stall or any shop. So what's the remedy available? Can the regulation now therefore say, maybe let somebody declare conflict of interest? Of course, in a number of acts, this happens. Then, of course, we had envisaged a number of things, the framers of the act, wherein I think we're talking of, let's actually have a full cascade number of things into the law. Of course, we're looking at the NDP 3, National Development Plan 3. We're looking at ILO conventions. For example, 100, we are looking at Social Security, 154, we're looking at 102, all these conventions. And then, of course, the Constitution. To mention, I think some of this point out this, when you look at Article 21 ED, Article 21 E, it talks of people having a right to freedom of association, including right to form unions. Mm. All this way, actually, cascade into this bill. And then, of course, things like formation of cooperatives. What went into mind was that I think, much as we have a legal regime, we have the vendors, the stakeholders, and the like. All this must be cascaded into this act, into the law.
Honorable, I'm sitting here listening to you and all these things, and my question now in my mind is, what exact existing problems is this law going to cure in the markets?
Of course, now what we wanted to cure, I mean, one, for example, when we talk of cleanliness, I think you have been seeing our markets. Mm. But I think that one is not a compliance issue. The act is saying cleanliness is one of the parameters where they can actually suspend. I think that was very important. Mm. Of course, you find that in some of the markets, you could not actually have structures. And then the other thing is that, for example, when somebody defaulted, what were the remedies available? So I think this now is going to put some stringent measures against all these people who are in the market, the store owners, so that they comply. Now, the other one is, for example, if you have been issued, given a shop in the market, you have taken 3 months. Mm. I think the law now is saying they can remove it from you. Then the other one, I think, to avoid the monopoly, where I think they have been saying maybe these things should be public. For example, you can see that we have areas where we have washing bays. They can now become markets because now under the 3 categories, we are talking of the public, we are talking of ways that might be temporary, or it can be a seasonal market. So we can now cause these markets. But of course, the other thing is that what we must understand that to build a market, I think, involves a lot of money. But I think we would ask implementers to be lenient. Maybe somebody has missed on something small, you cannot actually suspend and maybe say, I'm going to revoke. That one, again, can be a deterrence too.
You're talking about private ownership of markets?
Yes.
Okay.
Of course, we are going to have public and private markets under this law. And of course, it's now allowed. Of course, we are it is regulating. Of course, now, somebody will now go to, for example, if that market is located within maybe a sub-county, a municipality, a district, or for example, KCCA, this person should actually apply. And when this person applies, must be given feedback within 1 month. If they have denied that person, then the person is free to appeal to the minister. If the minister doesn't actually give that authority, then the person can go to court. Mm. Of course, this is now to provide remedies so that at least there is a balance. So that at least maybe if the local authority has issues with you, then you can go to the minister. Mm. Then you cannot actually rule out that. If the minister has also, you think you're not satisfied with the decision of the minister, then you go to court.
Can you talk to us about how this law is going to enable involvement of vendors in the day-to-day running of their market operations, actually?
And of course, the law is twofold. You are looking at the vendors are the people who are going into the market, which is already set. Let's say it's a public market. Let's say it's a private market. But even individual vendors, maybe I have my land somewhere, you're free to establish a private market. So I think this is now a sort of liberalization that is coming into play. Because I think people have been looking, you know, at the level of investment, people have been looking at apartments, but now even markets is an area you can actually invest.
Go ahead and invest.
Yeah, because for example, you can agree with your people within the law, and then you have a place, you're putting the structures, maybe there are stalls, then at least you can now start hiring them out. As long as you have been licensed and they are paying you within the agreed framework and within the law. So it's now allowed under this law.
Mr. Kiria here.
Yes, madam.
What problems do you think, as we speak now, this law is going to be curing when it comes to be on the part of the market vendors and their operations within the markets now?
No, you see, when you were asking Honorable Byakatonda, there is a question you asked him earlier on. Were the vendors really consulted when we are coming up with this law? First of all, I want to go on record that the amendment was started by us as Uganda Markets and Allied Employees Union. And then we forwarded it to our MP so that he can present it on the floor of Parliament together with these other colleagues that we voted. Now, we got involved in the whole process and the document was spurred. And it was passed by Parliament and everything was there. Mm. Our involvement was there. Our administrative, everything that we wanted was in the law. But then eventually along the way, things turned around. We just heard that Article 19 is out, 20 is out, 21 is out, 22 is out, 23 is out, 24, 25, 26, even 27. Now, all these articles, we are talking about the vendors, the involvement of the vendors in the management of the market. Along the way, even the democracy, the right to choose leaders was struck down. And they were saying that they are denying us that right because we are the ones, actually our management committees, we are the ones that we are bringing the confusion in the markets. And I want them to prove this in the courts of law. Because we are going to courts of law, you cannot take away the right to choose leaders from us. Even schools, I can construct a school, but there will be a head prefect. There can be other prefects in schools. Mm. How come that a market with the 500 vendors cannot have a right to choose leaders? And on top of that, when you are looking at 19 is talking about we having a right to choose the labor unions where we can.
That is, you're talking about the act before it was actually passed.
It was passed by Parliament.
Then it went to the president. That you're talking about.
Yeah, then it went to the president. Hmm. Then along the way, we don't know what happened. Most of all these things were out. Anything that involves a vendor to have a right to choose a leader, to have a right to say something, were struck out. Even, in fact, to the extent
that they are even saying that they don't want to see one cooperative
in the markets, any registered association in the markets. They don't even want to see partnerships in the market. You know? This is denying us all the rights.
At least the Markets Act does not talk about that.
The new one, that which was assented to by the president.
Yes, the Market Act of 2023.
It is talking about that one. All those things have been eliminated.
The Market Act of 2023, if I may just inform you, is talking about making provisions for determination of market fees and revenue collection. They are talking about minimizing conflicts between market owners and vendors, realigning governance and ownership challenges within markets, management of vendors, including the involvement of vendors in the market affairs. Sir, what are you talking about?
Somehow, maybe you have to revise, read the whole document. Because at the end of the day, they are telling you that actually it is the management committees in the markets When I'm talking about 19, 20, 21 and the others that were eliminated from that document.
The Market Act of 2023, because this is the document that
the,
has been
you go
passed.
Back and read what was struck out.
Yes,
from the, that the, document the before
proposed,
they coming up with that
the
one.
Proposed act before
yeah.
it was actually passed. That is what you're talking
now
about.
Now, what we have right now is administrators. They bring one person from the division and they put him in the market.
Yes, the act actually talks about introduction of administrators in markets.
Exactly.
That is correct.
Exactly. Now, but the involvement of vendors in the running of the running of the affairs of the market is out. We don't have any say in all of these things. Even when they're allocating stores, we don't have any say. Because what we had constructed before was to get some of the vendors on the procurement committee so that now every vendor in the market can get a chance to get a store, to get a shop.
Mm.
What is happening today when you go to Wandegeya market, you quickly discover that all the shops down were given out to government officials. OKCC officials.
Those are very serious allegations.
Exactly. You can go and find out. Even when you go to Lira, you'll find out the same thing. When they construct those markets, actually, Arua was going to be the same thing until when the union leaders went there, interacted with the RDC, and that's when they reversed the whole thing. Otherwise, they had allocated those things to themselves. Now, these are the very people who are saying that they don't want management committees to get involved in the allocation of these things because they want to give them, they want to give those things to themselves.
I think as of now, you have a choice.
Let me just bring in Honorable
yes,
here.
Yes, I think under that.
Let me just ask you something.
Yes.
In view of what he is saying, Uganda is known for passing very good laws and the problems get or come in at implementation level. Do you think this law is going to have the same problem listening to what he's saying?
I think the law is now very clear. Then it means he's very well armed with the instrument. Under Section 21, allocation of workplace shops, pitches, stalls, and public markets. And then I want him to read 11.
I understand what 11 says. First read. 11 is saying a person who is in the public. Let me use my glasses properly. Okay. A person who is in the public service of a local authority shall not be allocated a work space, shop, pitch, or store in a public market within the jurisdiction of that local authority. Now, this one can be, they can dodge this one by bringing in their relatives. Yes, they will bring
but
their relatives.
You see, Mr. Hassan.
They can allocate these things to themselves through other people.
You see, Mr. Hassan, if a government official did that, then that would be criminal under the law.
Yes. And I think you would
but
be
then
following
they
with
will
that.
Say, they will argue in the same breath, they will also say that my aunt, who is staying, for example, at Chireka, has a right to get a store in the market as a Ugandan.
But how does that change overnight?
Exactly.
They will say that. And at the end of the day, they will allocate those shops and the stores to their relatives or a friends.
You see, Hassan.
And at the end of the day, the vendor shall not get what is deserved to get.
Well, I do hear what you're saying, but also we need to be, of course, very cautious of the fact that this law has definitely already been passed, this Market Act of 2023. And that those things usually, yes, happen when there's implementation of the law, like I just asked him. But then also the law still establishes or gives provisions for investigations for police to get into these as some of the criminal activities or actions that could have happened. And then the culprits actually are brought to book. So I think we should look at it in that way as well.
At the end of the
Mr.
day,
Kiria.
The arguments that we have presented in striking down the committees, some of these arguments are not real. For example, somebody was saying that in St. Pali Kudembe market, now they are saying that there are landlords that are existing in that St. Pali Kudembe market. But then when you go back and read the policy guideline that was established by Mr. Adolf Mwesigye, Honorable Adolf Mwesigye, by then he was the Minister of Local Government. He had given authority to vendors to construct markets. And actually, Central Kudembe Market was constructed by vendors. People sold their property in the villages and everywhere, and they came and constructed those shops.
Honorable,
now today,
let me just bring in Honorable here. I do hear you. Do you think, with all these things that Mr. Akiria is picking here, do you think that the implementation of the Market Act of 2023 is going to be done to book, or we are going to have some challenges in lieu of some of these things that he's talking about?
I think Asana is an issue, but what I want to say under transitional provision schedule, all this must be addressed. What is important is for the implementers to handle it with objectivity and ensure that at least all stakeholders are enlisted properly. Then issues that are not addressed can actually come in with the regulations. Because there must be, because I think the purpose and intention of the framers of the law was not to criminalize and deprive people. Actually, they are saying even those that came in being 3 years should actually be considered, so long as they are in conformity with the act. I think this is what we are talking about. What are those? Some of them are mentioned in the act, and then they are saying any other issues that do not actually contravene the act. So if the issues, for example, when we talk of people forming unions, I think we need to benchmark and seek legal guidance on this. Does a union really affect the market? Okay, it may not be in the act, but what is the precedence? For example, where we have unions, let's talk of in institutions of higher learning, in education institutions, is it enshrined in the act? Or people are just going by the constitution? Because much as we are talking of the act, the constitution is supreme. And under Article 40, sub-clause 3, it also says people will be allowed to form associations, including unions of their choice. So does this deprive the vendors from this right? And of course, like I said, when we talk of under Social Security, want people to save. And now, recently in the act of, in the midterm, I mean the NSSF Act, we have actually said there shall be a voluntary saving. So does that deprive a vendor from really saving? Does it deprive a vendor from associating and or joining a union of their choice?
Partnerships,
I think all this. So you may find that when we seek maybe interpretation, we may actually understand some of this. And what I add,
so it looks like from what you're saying, there is need for sensitization.
Yes,
of these
sensitization, I think, is what is the key.
To the market vendors.
And before sensitization, I think we need to have the regulations. Then we see what are those gaps. Have they been addressed adequately by the line minister? If not, then we can actually seek. I urge the vendors really to engage and ensure that at least before, because even as it is, people may not actually know what are the issues really in the law. We need to disseminate it, we need even to change it in languages, because one, as a workers member of parliament, we have the formal and informal sector. And of course, the market union actually leads the informal sector. And of course, under the canons of organized labor, we need to have organized labor even in the markets. And it has actually been doing a lot of things. But of course, there are misconceptions. People who have their own interests to think they are not doing better, they are not doing this, we can do this. But I think under this law now, most of these can be streamlined and ensure that at least we move.
Thank you, Honorable. I will go for a short break and I will soon be back in just a short while.